Welcome. Thank you for coming so early on a Friday morning. I know it's probably been a tough week, so I'm really appreciative that you came here to the dungeon here at the at 8 a.m. on a Friday morning. It's the farthest you can go in the house. So yeah, very appreciative of that. My name is Asgeir Gunnarsson. I am a chief consultant of a consultancy in Denmark called Atheos. I do come from and live in Iceland though. So I probably traveled shorter than some of you here. We are going to talk about what is on in your Power BI environment, so basically about monitoring it. Before we start, there are a few housekeeping things, so please silence your phones. This session is recorded, so rings will, you know, put me off balance, and it's not going to be as much fun for all of us. If you haven't, you should definitely explore what PaaS has to offer. It has to offer so much more than just this conference. I know you've seen this slide many times this week, but you know, I still want to talk about it, especially the user groups. If you're, there is a user group close to you, I am absolutely certain of it. If it isn't, you start one, because you know it's a fantastic community and we should definitely be part of it. Okay. So as I said, my name is Asgeir. I have some contact information here. Slides are uploaded already. I have some tweaks to them that I will probably upload more today, very little. But my contact information is there if you want to, you know, get in touch, please do. I have been working in this industry for over 10 years. I'm a data platform MVP. I run the SQL user group and the Power BI user group in Iceland. You know, it's a small community, so it's, you know, not a lot in there. I have, you know, been working with Power BI since Power BI started. So this is of a particular interest to me, Power BI, and also especially, you know, these type of things that are a little bit difficult in Power BI. But before we go further, I'd just like to see which one, who of you are developing Power BI datasets and reports? Okay. Which one of you are Power BI administrators? Okay, a few of you. So this is a very common scenario that, you know, those who are good at developing Power BI reports, they become an administrator, just because nobody else wants to be it. So we just have to take the responsibility often. And also because Power BI is, you know, it's a little bit of a bastard within the Office 365 when it comes to administration. It's not quite in the Office 365, but it's not there, not quite out of it either. So it's a little bit of a little hard, you know, mix there. So that's why it's important that, you know, we take responsibility and try to do something about it instead of just, you know, leaving it as it is. Okay, so the agenda is this. I'm going to talk about, you know, why this topic a little bit, the few objectives for today. Then I'm going to dive into these things. I'm going to go through it, you know, layer by layer. It's just going to be 50-50 me talking and showing some slides and just showing actual things, how things work, or probably a little bit more demos than slides. So hope you appreciate that. So as again, why this topic? As most Power BI admins are accidental admins. They are not there because they are an administrator at heart, or they are there because that's their profession. It's because there's nobody else wants to do it, and because there is a, you know, a gap there that nobody is filling at the moment. So that doesn't mean that you don't have to know what's going on in your environment. Now, of course, you want to do that. There are several reasons, you know, why you want to do it. I'm going to cover them a little bit later on. But it's not really easy to do. There's plenty of things you can do manually. You can go in and check things. But that's maybe not really the right way to do things, you know, when you're doing, you know, proper monitoring of a, and now I'm talking a lot about Power BI in an enterprise scenario. So when it's, an enterprise is not necessarily 10,000 people company. Enterprise is also about 150 people company if it's just put out there for everyone. If that's your tool, then I would consider that an enterprise scenario as well. And then I think, you know, you still need to do the monitoring no matter, you know, what size of company you are. And it's really good to get this information out because it will help you. It will not only, you know, give you, you know, help with governance, it will also give you help with all kind of other parts of that. But it's a very important part of governance. Okay. Makes sense? Yeah, okay, let's dive into then. So the objectives of today is, well, hopefully when you're done here, you will know why you should monitor, you will know what you should monitor, how to do it and what to do with the data. So that's my, like, my fourth objective for today, and hopefully we will have covered them all, and you know, we will figure out in the end, but you know, I will appreciate your feedback, you know, if you don't think I did. So When I talk about Power BI governance, I have over time developed a little bit of a model for it, where I have like four pillars of governance. It's processes, it's training, it's monitoring and roles. This is some, like a method that I use normally when I go into companies to do Power BI governance. And monitoring is a really, really big part of that. The processes are probably also the equally big part, you know, even though some companies really don't like the word processes, and we just call it best practices or something. But monitoring is probably the key to it, and maybe the most difficult thing to do of all these four pillars. So that's what we're going to focus on today. We're going to focus on the monitoring part. Before we go to the fun stuff, the difficult stuff, so really the Power BI service, I just want to mention Power BI Report Server, because I know there are some people that are not using the cloud services. They're just using Power BI Report Server, and so how does it work in Power BI Report Server? Well, it's actually very, very simple in Power BI Report Server. You really don't have to work a lot for this. There is one table in the database, in the Report Server database. It's called Execution Log 3. Well, so it's called Execution Storage Log, but there's a view called Execution Log 3 that you can query, and it will have all the information. It's exactly the same way as if you were just running a normal reporting services server. It has a lot of information online about how to do it, and there are some, because of Power BI Report Server is a mix of reporting services and Power BI, there's not everything that works for reporting services works for Power BI as well. So just a quick demonstration of how that looks. Let me see, where am I? There I am there. Sorry, I forgot to turn on Zoom it. So I have a report server database here. It has just normal reporting server database. It has a bunch of tables, but in the view section, it has views called execution log 2, and execution log 3. It might sound a little weird for those who haven't looked at it, but this is for backward compatibility. So the reason was that when you had SQL Server reporting service in 2008, it was called execution log. I think 8.2, sorry. When it came up to 2012, it became execution log 2 because they added some fields, and there were so many third-party components that were using this view for monitoring purposes. So they just, instead of taking it away or changing it, they just added new ones, and then they added another one in 2016. But all the information is there. And if you just query it, and I have queried just some of the things, not everything, you will see, I'm just gonna scroll a little bit to the right here. You will see that I have queried some of them, and you see the format here. So you can see I have queried the Power BI desktop, the Power BI files, and I've also queried reporting services. There's one in the middle there, or in here, in this row here. That's a RPL, which is basically just a normal reporting services report. If you also have Excel in there, it will also have Excel type in there. The only thing that the drawback is a little bit here is that you can see the nice numbers here in it all. The time data retrieval, time processing, and time rendering, which is something that works really well with reporting service reports. There's nothing in there for Power BI, unfortunately. Because this was the great thing about reporting services. You can just go in and say, hey, I know now where my problem is with reporting services. It's in the rendering, it's in the data retrieval, or it's in the processing time. That doesn't work with Power BI reports. It just comes with start and end time. And one other thing is that there are something called report action here. And you can see the report action column over here. It has, for our reporting services report, it has one, which is rendered. But then it has 14 and 13 for Power BI reports, and there's no documentation anywhere what it means, unfortunately. I haven't found it, at least. So most likely, the 13 is rendering the report, and 14 is something else, which I don't know what it is. Because these things here, these five, are all one rendering of the report. So there are some little shaky things there with Power BI, but like I said, information is really nice and easy. And if you really, if there's something that you are running reporting server, Power BI report server, and you want to get this information out, I would recommend just pinging Microsoft support and saying, hey, I have this in my database. It has 13, 14. I cannot find any documentation. Can you help me? I'm going to do that at least, you know. So, you know, if I find out, I'm probably going to blog about it. But that's something that I just hadn't really, you know, done a lot of reporting services, Power BI report server work, you know. And there is a nice, you know, if you go to the documentation of the reporting services, you will see that they have a report action 1 to 9 documented. It's called this, you know, all these different things. But besides that, this will work pretty much exactly the same as reporting services. So I'm not going to spend any more time on it. This is like a very simple thing, and there's a lot of information online about it. Okay. If you only have Power BI report server, the rest is probably going to be not so valuable. Just so you know it. You know, I won't be offended if you stand up and go to see something else. Okay. So now we have gotten that out of the way. Now we start looking at the other stuff. So, as I said, monitoring is a big part of governance, and automation is your friend if you can do it. There are not everything you can automate, but it's really your friend, you know, if you really, you know, if you can do it, just, you know, I would definitely go for it. So you can use the API to create a report artifact inventory, and I'm going to go into it why it makes sense to do that. That's one of the parts we're going to talk about. You can also use the audit log to figure out what's going on in your environment, you know, who's doing what. That's a very, very important part of governance. And I would always, always, always recommend that if you are collecting this data in any way or shape, put it out there. No, there's confidential information, there might be like sensitive personal information, all these different things. You need to take, you know, that into account, but, you know, make sure it is actually available to other people because there's a lot of value in it. So these are my 4 sections today. First, I'm going to talk about Power BI admin settings. That's a manual process. There's no way to automate that. Sorry about that. But it's very important. Then I'm going to talk about the artifact inventory. Then I'm going to talk about activities. And I'm going to just, you know, go a little bit into capacities in the end, because there's one thing, you know, that's different with, you know, if you have premium capacities than it is with just normal things. But it's very, very simple. So main emphasis is on the first 3. So why would you do this? So first of all, you want to get insights, you know, not only from a governance perspective, but just in general. Imagine that, you know, you are implementing Power BI in your company, and then you are asked, you know, how is it going? How is the implementation going? Having data to really back that up is really, really important. You can use it for get more funding or just to, you know, make the team proud, or, you know, there's all kind of ways to do it. There's not necessarily like very specific auditing or governance questions. You can also use it for license maintenance, you know. So who is not using Power BI? I have like 500 Power BI Pro licenses out there, and I only have 300 active users. Maybe I can have 200 licenses I can put somewhere else, or maybe there are only 2 of licenses, but at least I know that they've been put into good use. Because it's very easy to take a license and move it from one person to another. There's nothing really hard about that for the Office 365 admins. So looking into who is using it is also really important just from a financial perspective. You can, you know, you can get a lot of, you know, good backing if you can bring data to the table instead of just having a gut feeling or, you know, saying, yeah, it's going great, you know, everyone is talking about it. You can actually come with some data. Make sense? Yeah? You're welcome to ask questions if you want during, or we can take them at the end. It's all up to you. So, first thing we want to talk about is the Power BI tenant settings in the Power BI admin portal. For those of you that don't know, the Power BI admin portal is a place within the Power BI service where you can go in and you can do some settings. There are plenty of them, and they're all kind of different things. So I'm going to jump over there, and we're going to take a look at it, and we're going to talk about what makes sense to do and what doesn't make sense to do. There's no rules in this because, of course, you know, we all have different ways of how we want to do things, how we want to run our things. So I'm now in the service. I've turned on the new look, just in case you didn't notice that. And I'm going to go to my settings, and I'm going to say admin portal. And hopefully the internet will work, it won't. That was good. Come on, you can do it. So let's try it again. Well, it didn't work. So the admin portal has different things in there. So First of all, it has this usage metrics thing, so which, you know, shows you the usage of your tenant. Now, if you are on a big tenant, you know, hundreds of users or thousands of users or tens of thousands of users, it's going to be crowded with all kinds of different things. I have a tenant of two people. This is my demo tenant, basically. So this is where I use for these talks. And you can see there's not a lot going on here. Now, one thing, a word of warning or advice, these data here, they don't, you cannot substitute the audit log for this. This will not be as precise as that. For some reason, which I don't know, this is just not exactly as precise as the audit log. That's like Max would have actually, I have asked and they have said that. So don't take this as a holy thing, you know, but it is a good indication. There are several other things down here, and you can see the coupling to Office 365 is very obvious when you press on users. It says like go to the Office 365 admin center, audit log, go to the Office 365 admin center, but the rest is actually, you know, local to Power BI. So the one I want to talk specifically about is the tenant settings. There are 31 settings in the tenant settings. And there are things in there that, you know, you probably have, everyone has heard of this, you know. You should turn off, you know, publish to web. You should, you know, take a decision on what you want to do about external sharing. There are all kinds of different things in here that you need to do, you need to make a decision on. So my advice to you and to everyone I meet, you know, which are, you know, doing Power BI administration is like, go in here, look at it, take an active decision on each one of them. When you have done that, write it down. So write every single setting down in a document, saying, you know, my first setting, let's publish get help information. It is set to disabled. Second one is this, and it's set to enable for this group of people or whatever. So the reason why I tell you that that is important is that you have, if you have more than one administrator in your company, there is actually no traceability of whatever happens in here. So if I go in here now and change this, and we are more than one administrator, the other administrator will have no idea about it. There's no traceability. There's no log about it anywhere that I know of, at least. There's probably somewhere in the Microsoft background. But there's nothing you can fetch. So if you don't write it down, and if you don't actually monitor this, which is absolutely manual monitoring, you might be in a situation where someone has accidentally or by purpose turned something on, changed some settings that will... will not be in accordance to your governance policy. That could be like something like external sharing, like publish to web, all these different things that are, you know, potentially dangerous to your company, but there could also be other things that you wanted to be in a specific way and they have been changed in another way. So again, my advice, write it down, make a document, and then make your administrators, you know, once a month or something like that, go in there and just make sure it is what it should be. It is not a lot of effort, you know. Creating the document is maybe a couple of hours. You can do it, you know, with screenshots, or you can write it down or whatever you want to do. And monitoring it, it's you know, half an hour work, that's, you know, once a month. It shouldn't be too hard for a you know, administrator to do. There are, of course, other things than the tenant settings that you probably would and should, you know, thinking if you do Power BI Premium, you should look at the capacity settings. The embed codes, of course, really, really important. These are the publish to web and other embed codes. Unfortunately, it doesn't really say if it, you know, is only what type of embed code this is, but it at least is here and you can get an overview of it. So you can see, because this one used to be publish to web, but now I have turned on publish to web, so this one is disabled. So there, if you just disable the publish to web, you know, there's probably going to be very little in here, and depending a little on how you work. So. There's one other thing I want to mention here that is good to keep a track on, is the workspaces part. It will show you all your modern workspaces, so the type 2. What is good thing about this one is, so this is just an admin thing, this is not really monitoring thing, but what is good about this is that if a person that owns a workspace leaves your company, then the workspace becomes an orphan workspace. You can go in here actually and assign a new owner to it. So it's just a tip that it always not. But this only works with modern workspaces. It doesn't work with the type 1 workspaces. I actually saw a tweet just before we started that down at Ignite, Adam Saxton is showing today some new migration experience going from type 1 to type 2. So apparently there's something in the works there. You know, we all love, would love to be just on type 2. That would be best for everyone. Okay. I have written some of the settings down. I just did, which I think, you know, something you might want to modify, which is published to web. And, you know, and you, oh, one other thing I forgot to mention. You should definitely turn on the locks. So it's in the tenant settings. It is like turn on the locks for Power BI. It's off by default. Turn them on, and they will start collecting it. And there's also one other setting that I think is very, very helpful. Again, not maybe necessarily monitoring. It's in the tenant settings, you can put in internal help sites. So instead of, you know, when people go in the Power BI service and they press the question mark, they go to, you know, seek help, they can go into internal sites instead of going to Microsoft, you know, external sites. It's a very, very helpful one. Okay, any questions about the tenant setting or the admin portal? Yep. Yeah, so the question was, is there any opportunity with MS Graph and Power BI admin? Unfortunately not. So it is a little weird how it is some coupled with Office 365, but in some way not. At least I have not found any API that will allow me to do any of the monitoring, any of the admin part of Power BI, no, the admin portal part. I have looked, but I haven't found. Yes? You need to have the Power BI administrator role, which is an Office 365 role. So it is actually not very invasive role because it only gives you this, but nothing else than that. So you can actually be a Power BI admin without being any Power BI developer, you know, anything like that. Yeah. No, so I wouldn't say there's absolutely no, but you know, it's unmeasurable. That's at least what they say, and at least that's my experience as well. So we will come back to the logs. There are a couple of things about them that we need to think about, but there shouldn't be any performance hits on it. Okay, let's move on to the other next part, which is the Power BI artifact inventory. When we are talking about the Power BI artifact inventory, we are talking about, you know, what do we have of things in the Power BI? So things like, you know, how many dashboards do we have? How many repos do we have? You know, how many workspaces do we have? How are they all linked together? You might think, you know, oh, why would you want to have that? But there are quite a few applications of this data. First of all, it's very nice to see how things are growing over time. So how am I doing in my implementation? Now, of course, if things are not growing, it doesn't necessarily mean that you're doing badly, because, you know, you might just be enhancing, or, you know, your reports are really great. But at least if you're getting more objects in there, there's an indication, there's an activity at least. Something is happening. Another thing that I have had great success with using this data is to create just a proper artifact inventory to expose to all users in the company. Because if you don't have access to a workspace or to an app, you don't know what is out there. So you don't know what reports are in your tenant if you don't have access to it. So by exposing this to everyone, you can allow people to browse your inventory and say, hey, oh, there's a finance report here about, you know, cost of the department cost that I could be really interested in. It's owned by James over here. Maybe I should, you know, contact him and ask him if I can access to it. So these are the things that we have had actually great, you know, success with, you know, in our consultancy doing this for customers, because, you know, it is so difficult to figure out what it is. Now, of course, the dream scenario would be if we could just compare it somehow, saying, hey, there's a duplicate things here, but we cannot do that. We cannot really go into the code really and compare things. Unfortunately, not yet. That would be absolutely the dream scenario, so we can get rid of duplicate things, because as we all know, there are a lot of those things in Power BI, unfortunately, as it was in Excel. But to be able to collect this data, you will need to use the Power BI REST API. Now, I am not a developer of such. I do Power BI, I do BI, I've done BI for many years, but I don't program. So REST APIs have always been I always found them a little bit difficult, but they are Power BI. Microsoft has actually trying to make this as easy as possible for us. They've actually been really good at making it so that, you know, we can access it and use it without a lot of effort. So just jumping over to here to see what we have. So Power BI has a REST API site, And it has a few different sections in it. Now, the interesting thing I think about it is that it has, so the first section is called admin, and then the next one is called apps and all these different things. So and within each section, there's a different endpoint that you can use to get different things. All right. There's a bit of an overlap in this. So the admin might include something like, get me all the reports in the workspace. But the workspace one will also give you the same thing. Or the report one will also give you the same thing. This is, I think, the historically thing with Microsoft, they have two different teams. So one team is doing the admin part, one team is doing the other part. And this doesn't always work exactly the same. So you have to actually read the definition to understand what it is giving you. So for an example, if we go to the admin part here, and if we go down to, so get groups as admin. Groups, in this case, are workspaces, because they used to be called groups. The type one workspaces were Office 365 groups, and they just haven't been changing this name of this. So it's all just called group. And if you see, it says returned a list of workspaces for the organization. And you can use either the whole, get everything, or just get what you own yourself. But if I go down to the groups part here, and say get groups, it returns a list of workspaces the user has access to. So there's like a slightly different thing here. So one is like all the things you can have access to, and the other one is everything. So the admin API will generally have that, it will be allow you to get everything in your tenant as long as you are a Power BI administrator, while the other ones will allow you to get whatever you have access to. So you don't actually have to be an administrator to use the APIs, you just will only get what you have access to. And of course, normally in most companies, you won't have access to everything. That would be awful if you had, because you don't want to have 250 workspaces in your list. There's no reason for that. So that's why the admin API is often better. So as you see, there are things about it that you can do. So this is basically just a URL, as REST APIs often are. And if you actually copy paste this into a browser and you have the right, it will actually show you the results of it. So it's very easy to test. But if you want to actually use this for something more than that, you will have to write some code. And that could be, you can write an application for this. If you are a good developer, you can just write an application. I'm not very good at that, so I just wanted to have something more simple. And there actually comes PowerShell to the rescue. So PowerShell can do a lot of these things. And what Power BI has done for, what Microsoft has done for us, is they've taken a lot of these endpoints, and they have wrapped them into Power BI commandlets. So you don't actually have to know how to call them, basically. You just have a small line says, this organization, it gives you everything. So they have been doing a lot of these help for us. And there's actually a quite good documentation on it. So first of all, I have links for all this in my slides, by the way. So there's a site here which will describe the commandlet, what it is and how you install it. And there's another site here that will show you some of these things that you can do. So how to install a model, how to do these different things. It's a nice site that would actually show you just how to run PowerShell commandlets. It's really, really nice. What they have done also beside that, which is what they have done to help us sit along. But they are, because they have to do some programming to encapsulate these endpoints into a commandlet, what they have also done for us is they have created a separate commandlet that allows us to invoke a REST method without knowing exactly how to do it. We just give it a URL and then it will do it. So instead of writing a bunch of PowerShell code to invoke a REST method, they have encapsulated that for us as well. So we can just write very simple code in our PowerShell. So we should be very thankful for this. It will allow some accidental developers like myself to do all of these things without a lot of effort. So how does it look? Let's go and take a look. So here I have PowerShell. And I will zoom in just a second, don't worry. So there are things that you need to think about. There are a couple of things that, for this, and no matter what, if you're doing it in PowerShell or you're doing it in your own web application or whatever you're doing, there are things that you need to do to make it work. First of all is authentication. And authentication is not fantastic. Yeah, it can be a little bit difficult. So you have three options for authentication. First of all, you can actually just do it like I do it here. It's just something called login Power BI. So it's just a commandlet that's called login Power BI. If I run that, it will just ask me to log in. Very, very simple. It works perfectly for me. Now I'm logged in, now I can run all the commandlets. But of course, this is unusable for any kind of automation. Because you know, you don't want to be sitting by the console every time this runs and clicking on the link or anything like that. So there are one other option is you can actually just put the username and password in here. It's going to be in plain text. So you have to think about that. And it usually needs to be a Power BI admin account. You can, of course, encrypt these things. You can encrypt the file. You can use Windows credential store. There's things you can do for it. But then you're tied to the machine. But it's still something that's possible. The third way to do this is to use a service principle. So this is something that came in February. This is if you are doing a proper automation, that would be the preferred way to do it. It requires some setup. You need to have access to Azure portal. You need to start and create an application. You need to do a bunch of things that that are maybe not on everyone's in everyone's grasp, but this is the preferred way. So if you have any developers, have your Office 365 or Azure admins in your company, you get some help to do these things. When you have created a service principle, you can run it, and if you want to do it really securely, you could do it for example, an Azure automation job, where you will have the credentials in the key vault, and you can do it really, really, really properly. But it depends a lot on your situation, where you are in your in your journey, and how secure do you really need it? Can you get away? What can you get away with? There's all these things. Of course, the more secure, the better. The more automated, the better. But I know that not everyone is in the same situation. They can do whatever they want all the time. So, okay, I'm logged in. Any questions about the authentication before I go any further? Okay, you can ask again later. So, what we want to do now is we want to look at different types of the way you can do this in PowerShell. So first of all, I have a code here, which is called get Power BI workspace. And this is a commandlet that Microsoft has created. And it takes one argument, which is scope, and another one, which is all, or you always have to use the all if you use the scope organization, basically. It's very, very simple. It will give you all the workspaces in your tenant. If you're an admin, it will give you everything. If you're not an admin, you will only get what you have access to. And I'm just going to run it and show you the results of it. So there are a couple of things that you need to think about when it comes to it. So let me see. Whoop. So we'll run it. Below here, it's going to come a list. It was very fast. I'm in a very small tenant. I have something like 40 workspaces, which is a lot for two people, right? But it's because there's all these old Office 365 things in there as well. It's all the personal workspaces as well. There's all the Teams workspaces. There's all these things that are there's all that in there. But what at least it does help you with. So if I just go a little bit like this and scroll a little up here. So you can see, that didn't work well. Wow. What did I do? Thank you. So let's try again. Thank you. You can see it now. Yeah. So first of all, you can see that this one here is a personal group, meaning this is a private workspace. I can get a list of all the workspaces, even the private workspaces, the my workspaces of everyone. So you can get a list of them all. Of course, there's only one admin in that. So below there is access rights and user principal name. There's always ever going to be one person in a my workspace. There cannot be more, so this is always going to be just one there. Very, very simple. Now, if I go up again here, let me see. I need to probably go a little further up. Boom. So let me see here. Show you here. See the one in the middle here? It has of a type group. Type group means this is a, you know, are the old type of workspaces, Office 365 workspaces. This could be also a Teams channel. This could be, you know, all these different things that actually could, you know, impact your Power BI environment. You will get them all here because this is, they're all interconnected. Hopefully that won't now be forever, but it's what it is. And if I go a little bit up again. Now we see something different. Now we see something called workspace. And that is the modern workspaces. So the type two of them. So you can, when you have, you can either take it all in and then filter away what you don't want, or you can just take it all in and then, you know, have some way of identifying. You can allow people to choose, I only want to see the modern workspaces, I only want to see the personal groups or whatever you want to. Of course, you know, in my small tenant, there's always going to be only one person who has access to each workspace, but there is, you know, if there were 10 people who had access to the workspace, you will get all of them in the list here. Yes? Not in this one. This is only workspaces, nothing else. We will come a little bit back to how we can start to, you know, mix things up, you know, a little bit. That's also one of the drawbacks about it. You know, I'll get back to you just in a second. So, you know, I forgot, sorry to ask, you know, so the question was, you know, are you able to see which one has content or which one don't have content? We cannot, you know. Yeah, sorry, first, So the question was the access rights on the screen, if it's an admin, doesn't mean it's a Power BI admin. No, it means that this role is an admin role on the workspace. So they could be admin, member, contributor, or reader. Yeah. Yes, sir. Yeah, so if there's more, you know, people have access to the workspace, would they be listed? Yes, and with their role type. So you get members and, you know, readers and all that, you know. Yes, you would get that, which is a really nice one. Yes. No, so there's nothing really to handle it. The question was, you know, so how do you handle workspace creation over time using the API? So what you can do, so this is, my session is only about getting, but there are other API endpoints about creating. So there's very differently how people handle it. Some people say, just knock yourself out, you know, you can create whatever you want. Some people, some companies, they restrict what you can do, what you can create, and then they either use the API or use it, or some other method to create workspaces for people. They can do it manually, or they can use an API to do that, which basically they can automate that. I saw a really nice solution from a UK-based company where they had, you know, had a form you filled out. It was all automated, so you filled out the form, and the form got sent to a person to approve it. If they approve it, the workspace got created, the person got put into it, and then the BI group got put into it as admins as well. And then they got a notification saying, hey, your workspace is ready, and this is the link to it. So all these things can be done with the APIs. It's just another part of this session here. So it's more of a create scenario where I'm more in a read scenario. So this is nice information, and if you can output this to something. So I'm just outputting it to a window. You can output this to a CSV file, database, whatever you want, if you want to then collect it. So that's, of course, what I'm, you know, suggesting to you to do, that you will actually collect this, not just output this in the window. Doing spot checks is fine, but we want to do something more with it. Now, I'm going to just show you one other thing very quickly, another command, which is called get Power BI report, scope organization. Again, now I will get all the reports in my tenant, because I'm a Power BI admin. And if we take a look at it, you will see it has an ID, it has a name, it has a web URL, it has an embed URL, and it has a dataset ID. Now, the interesting thing here is that it does not say anything about workspace. So it's just a list of all the reports, nothing to where is it actually. So you don't have the, you can, now we have seen the list of all the workspaces, we have seen a list of all the reports, but no link between them. And this is one of the reasons why they are always evolving these APIs. So they're always making new ones, making them nicer. And you know, they cannot keep up with commandlets. So that's why they have created this nice commandlet for us, which is called invoke REST, Power BI REST method. So This one basically allows us to invoke any of the Power BI REST endpoints by simply giving it a URL and whatever optional parameters that are needed in the URL. Or, you know, we need it or, you know, optional. Yes, sorry. Yeah. Well, so the question was, well, it was two times Vienna. No, that is because there are, you know, there actually exists two copies of a report in two different places. So, because this is no connection, so it could be in two different workspaces called exactly the same. And unfortunately, it actually could be in two different, the same workspace has been called exactly the same at the moment. There is a bug at the moment in Power BI if you are using shared data sets that you can actually, you know, come have this situation, which is a little bit unfortunate, but this is actually two different workspaces. Yeah. So the invoke Power BI, Power BI REST method does help us to, you know, instead of having to write code that, you know, we needed to call a proper, you know, REST, you know, API endpoint in PowerShell, it will wrap all those things together for us. So we simply need to give it the URL, and then we are good. The API I'm using here is the API endpoint, sorry. It's under here. It's this one here. So, no, sorry, it's not this one here. Sorry about this. It's the, yes. It's missing the admin part. Groups, get groups as admin. Yes, this one here. So this is an API endpoint that will give you all the workspaces as an admin. That's really nice, but remember, that's actually what we did before. So we got all the workspaces before. But what they have done with this endpoint, which, you know, they haven't yet managed to encapsulate in the commandlet, is that they have added a new optional parameter called expand. And expand does give me all the related objects that are in there. And it can give you the reports, the dashboards, the data flows, the users. These things that can give you. And data sets, sorry, and data sets. So you can see all these different things here. So what I can do now is I can call this one here. And the only thing I give it the URL. So I give it the URL. I add the expand at the end. So expand to give me reports, dashboards, data sets, users, and data flow. I don't have to get them all. I can do whatever, you know, choose whatever I want. And then I say, in the end, just method get, because that's what I'm doing here. If you want to create something, it would be a post method instead. So if I run this now, it will give me a little bit differently looking thing. It will give me a JSON instead of giving me, what they have done when they have encapsulated the endpoint in the commandlets, they have actually nicely outputted it into a tabular format. But the REST APIs in general, they will give you a JSON back. That's, you know, that's okay, we can handle JSON. You know, we are Power BI people, we can handle JSON, but, you know, it's not always that much fun. So let's see how this looks like. So instead of doing that, looking at it here, I'm just gonna go here, and I'm gonna go and find a JSON file here. Look at it in Notepad. So the interesting thing is it will say, it will be some kind of a, you know, what type of JSON is this? And then it will say, okay, first of all, I have an ID of a workspace. And then underneath each workspace, I will have some reports. I will have some dashboards, I will have some data sets, I will have some users, and I might have some data flows. Of course, maybe I have nothing in here. Maybe I have only reports or only, you know, dashboards or whatever it is. But at least it will show me all these things related together, which is really, really nice, because now I can do the linking here. Now I can link this all together. So with one command line, I will actually get all these five things, and I will get them all, you know, related to each other, which will allow me to do a proper lineage thing. But it's not everything. You don't get everything from this. So, for example, there's no mention of apps. There's nothing really about apps in there. So there is another endpoint called apps, where you can get apps, and you can get app reports. So you will get all the reports that are in the app, and then you can start trying to link things together. It is a little bit cumbersome because, you know, now you have, you know, one, so now you will need to create a proper data model if you want to do this properly. So my suggestion to you is, you know, you will figure out what you want, you try to get it, and then you will, you know, build up the proper data model. The same thing goes for data set refreshes. If that's something you're interested in, you can go and get that here as well. But then you will need to, then you do the data sets, get these refreshes, and then you have linked the data set to the data set that was in the other one, and then that's linked to the report, which is linked to a workspace, right? So you can get a proper data model. Now, it gets a little bit complicated when you are, you know, starting to do that. If you're not a seasoned PowerShell developer, which I'm not, you know, you get into a little bit of, it gets a little bit more complicated than it was before. But it's not too horrible. So let me show you how that could work. So first of all, you can decide, you know, this is just a simple PowerShell script that will just call few things. Doesn't really, it's not just what I, so it will give you all the capacities, all the gateways, all the report, and all the, you know, workspace with all the reports, and nothing linked together, just, you know, a few things. You can call them all in just one of these, you know, if you want, and output it. This is outputting this all to a CSV file or a JSON file, depending on what it is. One, very simple. But what if you want to do that, for example, apps and all the reports that belong to the apps? There's nothing really, let me back up just a second. So the one with apps, so let's say get apps. It will give you all the installed apps, basically, and say get reports. The get reports will force you to give you an app ID. So you need to tell it, you know, this is an app ID. So there's no way of give me just all apps and the reports that belong to them. So that means you need to iterate or loop through things. So it gets a little bit more complicated. And that's what I'm doing here, for example. Here I'm saying, give me all my apps, then for each and every app, give me all the reports. So it's basically a while loop within my PowerShell. When you have done one of these, you can do all of them because it's very, you know, structure is just the same for everyone. You know, if you're not, like say, if you're not used to doing PowerShell, you will need to just look at it once, go through it a little bit, and then you will be able to do it. And for example, for data refreshes, then I will just give me all the workspaces. In it, give me all the data sets. Now, for each workspace, give me all the data sets. For each data set, give me all the refreshes. So now you're to three layers. And you know, you don't have to do it like that, but that's how I want it because I want to have relate them all together. So it can get a little bit complicated, but there's a lot of help out there. There's a lot of help on the internet about it. I have found a lot of inspiration from guys like Rob Sewell, and there are other people out there that write a lot of PowerShell that actually been doing, even though they're not Power BI people, they have been doing some of the Power BI work as well, which give you inspiration to how to do it. There's also I have a link here. There's a link, it is in my slides. It is a guy who decided that he wanted to if a refresh failed, he wanted to start it up again. So basically, he wanted to monitor if a refresh failed, and then he wanted to start it up if it did fail. So this was a great inspiration for me because it has, you know, a bunch of things in the code. We had a bunch of PowerShell code here that, you know, do loops, will, you know, do things. It will check if, you know, if this parameter is like, you know, if this part of the result is like this, then do that, and all these different things. So it's a great, you know, inspiration from a person who actually knows how to do PowerShell properly. So this is a link in my data as well. Besides doing this, what I like to do as well, and this is something that you need to figure out if it makes sense for you. What I like to do is that I like to get information from Active Directory about people. So because you will get, you know, in the API I showed you before, API endpoint, you will get users of workspace. Unfortunately, you cannot get users of apps. That's just not possible. It's a really big gap at the moment. But you can at least get workspace users. What you can do then, if you get data from Azure Active Directory, you can also start to know, saying this person belongs to this group, or this person, depending on your Active Directory, belongs to this unit, your organization unit. It's in this department. It's in this whatever. So if you start doing that, then you can actually get a really good information about saying, okay, we can start to tell, if these people, work in this particular department or using Power BI more or not, or if they are, admins often or not, all these different things that, can help you also in your journey to expose this data, in a really nice way. I have a sample script for that as well. It's very, very simple. It will log into Azure Active Directory, and it will give me, so this one is just giving me all the groups, all the owners of the groups, and all the members of the groups, and all the users. You can just link it all together. But that's just, like a group thing. If you really want to know, so most, I'm not going to say most, many Active Directories have organizational units as well. Which that's where you really get the good part, in my opinion at least. The sample script is part of the package, so you can get that if you're interested. Okay. So, any more questions about the artifact inventory? There's one thing I haven't mentioned really, which is what do you do when you run this PowerShell? You can output it into a JSON, you can output it into a CSV file, you can output it into everything. Yes, sir. So the question was, if classifications that they just announced Monday are in a way, no, there's nothing there. So usually they will start with the GUI only, and then they will create APIs. Except for the admin stuff, they normally have created APIs first, and then a GUI. But in this case, they have just created just the GUI part of it. So there's no API to fetch any of these, unfortunately. And neither fetch nor print. Yeah, I don't post it. Hopefully it will come. Yes. So you can find out which reports use which dataset. Yes, you can do that. Not which people, because the problem here is the apps. So if you are sharing through apps, we have no way of seeing any users of apps, unfortunately. So I just want to tell you before we go any further is that the API REST API output JSON, some of it, the commandlets will output a nice table. Depending on how good you are in PowerShell, you can either handle all this in PowerShell and output this into a CSV file or a table, a database or whatever you want. If you are not very good at PowerShell and you have a hard time handling this, converting things and stuff like that, you can just output it all to files and then of course consume those afterwards. What I have found out is that Power BI has no problems with these JSON files or these CSV files. But of course, maybe you don't want to necessarily put it straight into Power BI. I would recommend putting it into a database and doing doing some proper data modeling on it. If you want to do that, there could be some issues. First of all, Azure Data Factory has problem with the JSON files that come from Power BI. Because remember if you saw it. So you can see here in the top there is an at symbol. There are two of them in there. Normally there's only one, but Azure Active Directory doesn't like the at symbol, so you need to escape it with another at symbol. Then it will have no problems with it. But if you don't, it will fail. Microsoft Flow doesn't like it either. Integration services, if you're on a newer version, it will have the Power Query source. Absolutely loves it, no problem. Of course, now Azure Data Factory with the new wrangling data thing that just it all got into into preview, into public preview on Monday. That also is a Power Query, basically, is in Azure Azure Data Factory. And that potentially can do that as well. It should be able to, at least when it's fully fledged. Logic apps can do this. So there are quite a few places that can do this, but you need to figure out where fits best for you. You need to find out where you do it. I found it easier just to output it all and then consume it all with my favorite integration tool. But if you are good at PowerShell, you can just all do that all in PowerShell, make it really nice. Okay, we continue to the next session, which is about the activities. So activities is about adoption, about governance. It's about auditing all these different things. So who is using Power BI? Who is not using Power BI? Who is viewing? Who is modifying? Who is deleting? All these different things, that's what is in your audit log. Luckily, so this is a two-way thing here. Luckily, it is actually fairly easy to get to. The main issue is that it's very hard to get access to. That's at least my experience. Because the problem is that the audit log lays within the Office 365 Security and Compliance Center. And if you ask your Office 365 admin to give you access to it, he will most likely say no. If you can bring him gifts or something, it is really, really important to get access to it, but it's really difficult. And the main issue is that you cannot get access only to Power BI logs. Either you get access to all the logs in Office 365 or none of them, which makes it very hard for them to give you access. Because there are things in there about threat intelligence and file access and all these different things that could potentially be completely out of your pay grade. So that's why it can be really, really difficult to get access to it. I have found that sometimes it works for me to say that, okay, I will bring you whatever you need and you will own it. Now that's if you have a good administrator say, okay, yeah, I will take extra work just for you. But at least it will make them feel more secure about it. Because then they don't have to give you an account. They will just be able to run it themselves and I will just take care of the output of it. That is something that have had some success with. Some companies are really happy or lucky where they will just get access. That's fantastic. So let's take a look at it a little bit. Boom, boom. So in your Power BI admin portal, you have something called audit logs. If you have not turned it on, it is in the tenant settings. Somewhere in here, there is do you want to turn on audit logs? And I was like, highly recommend, do it. Turn it on. Worst case scenario, you won't do anything about it. But best case scenario, you can collect it and do something. But if you turn it on, at least it's there. It is by default only held for 90 days. Your Office 365 admin can change that, but he can change it to a lower number if you want. If you want to change it to a higher number of days, he will have to pay more. So usually it's always 90 days because they don't want to pay more unless there are some really compelling reasons why you would have collected longer. So if you are not collecting it from there, it will only have 90 days worth of history, which is, in my mind, it's maybe a little bit too little, but at least it's a start. So when you have turned it on, if you have access, you can go to the Office 365 admin. So this is the Security and Compliance Center within Office 365. And there you will find the unified audit log. In it, as I said, is every single log that is in Office 365. There's no discrimination on what it is. It's all in there. And if I go down here and I say search for Power BI, you will see all the Power BI activities that are in. There's a lot of them, and they are always getting more and more. So they are things like edited a Power BI dashboard, copied Power BI dashboard, viewed Power BI tile. So it's pretty granular. But it's it has a bunch of things in here. Let me just see something here. Viewed Power BI report. I'm going to choose that. You can choose more. You can also choose created a Power BI report. So now I have selected two of them, and you can select a bunch. But you cannot select all of them because the GUI here cannot handle that. Of course, if you, when we look at later on to automate this, you know, that is no problem. But the GUI here can only handle 20 or something. Or this is like 50 or something in there. But let's just say I will select these, and I will say, oh, sorry, where is it? So view, and now is it to search? Yeah. And there's not a lot of activity in my tenant, so this is going to come with, oh, nothing, okay. It's because this is only for this month. Let me go a little bit further back. So this is, of course, just spot checks. Here I can go in and say, okay, who did access, who deleted that? Simple thing. I can export this to a CSV file, and then I can work with that if I want. But it's very, very, very simple. If you're so lucky to have access but not in a position to do any kind of automation on it, at least you can do this. You can go in here, take everything, export it to CSV, and then go with it. But what we really want to do is we want to automate this. We want to collect this. We don't want to be just doing the same thing over and over. So go back to here. Oh, I haven't opened that up. I have a very, very simple PowerShell script here. And what it does, it says, give me the audit log. It has a connection string to it. This is Office 365 REST API endpoint. And I have, give me some period of time and, result size of 5,000. I have another script in my package that will do paging as well. So if you have more than 5,000 results, which like you probably will in your initial one, if you take a long period, it will know how to page through those different results. So get 5,000 time, at 5,000, at 5,000, at 5,000. You can also just take one day at a time and just collect it in that way. It depends on how you want to do it. So this one will just give me the whole audit log, everything. Now if I open another one here, let me see. Yes, everything. So here I have added a simple thing in here called record type Power BI. This will give me only the Power BI log. But I say because you cannot get access to only part of it, this is no type of security. There's nothing there that will, this is just basically saying I don't want to look at the other things, but I can if I want. So just keep that in mind. So is the 5,000 the limit or just the speed thing up? It is a limit. The API is throttled, so it will only give you 5,000 at a maximum at a time. So that's why you want to you wanna throttle it, because otherwise if you just don't put anything on it, it will just give you the first 5,000 and you don't know about it. But if you put 5,000 on it and then do the paging, you will be able to get all of them. So out of this, if you just output this, it will give you I have exported this to a CSV file. It just gives you a bunch of things. The thing you need to be aware of here is that, so even though I put this out to a CSV file, it will have things like, computer runs, all these different things, but then it will have audit data, and that audit data is a JSON within your CSV. So you will need to be able to handle that, That, you have both, you have one column is a JSON, script. So let's just take a quick look at that, how it works, how it looks. And Power BI Desktop has no problems with these things, the problem if you put this just into Power BI Desktop, if you're exporting your log every day, let's just say that you do it, I would recommend that you take all the 90 days, and then the next day you will take a new day. If you use Power BI Desktop only to report on this, you will have a lot of files in the end, even though you do like from folder, and it can handle a lot of files, but after a year you will have 366 files, after 2 years you will have 700. It's gonna be a lot of files. So that's why I recommend putting it into a database somewhere. instead of just, you know, putting it in. But it is really nice and easy to start in Power BI. Oh, sorry. I'm going to go get data. I'm going to go say text CSV. And I'm going to go here. So this is very, very simple. I just want to just quickly show you how it looks. So this is just a CSV, but you can see in the audit data part here, you will have a JSON in there. Like I said, Power BI has no problem, you know, parsing JSON out of this, but you know, some other systems might have that. You need to figure out how you want to parse that. But that's basically it. So the audit log is simple to get data from. You don't, so there's one other thing I want to maybe say about, you know, in the PowerShell script itself. So I have, I'm just taking everything. So while I can put the record type equals Power BI, which is to give me just Power BI, you can also tell it what activities you want. If you're only interested in certain activities, you can put that in as well as, you know, as parameters. I'm not necessarily, you know, recommend that. I would personally always collect everything, because especially for auditing purposes and for governance purposes, you don't really know what you will need until it, you know, something comes up. So it can be, I would probably not omit anything unless you are absolutely sure that you will never need it. Okay, so just to give a quick glimpse, this is the data model I created just in Power BI. I didn't create anything database or anything. I have it in database as well, but I just wanted to show you there's a data model in there. It is not very, you know, easy, nice, or clean, but it has a plenty of objects in there. So you have like your users, your workspace users, your apps, your reports, your dashboards, you know, you have your workspaces, and you have your gateways, and you have, you know, all these different things in there. You can get capacities, and you can get capacities workloads. There are a bunch of things in here that you can get that you can then put into a proper report and do some nice reporting on it. So what I have here, it's just an example of you know, what you can do. So I have a very simple report with very little data in it because it's my small tenant. What I have, you know, something like, you know, how many active users do I have? Or how many users do I have? So depends on how you want to count it. Active is whatever you want to decide what is active. How many active reports do I have? How many, you know, reports in total? This can also be a cleanup housekeeping thing, you know. Is there a report that hasn't been touched for, you know, for months? Maybe I should just get rid of it. Maybe I should archive it somewhere. Maybe it's not needed. And then, you know, just over time, most active workspaces, how many users are active over time? So I just added one user here so it wasn't flat. It's boring to look at. And then the reports that have had most views of all reports. Then I have a few things about, you know, users and the activity of users. So I have, you know, how active are the users? What are they doing? Which one of them are most active? And then, you know, some users that have, you know, have been inactive for a long time. So the top one there. So you see the first one. It's a little interesting one. It's a GUID. It's because that user doesn't exist anymore. So it's basically an orphan. It's been deleted. But you can see these people are very, very inactive. 190 days since they actually did anything. So that's also something that you can think about. You know, maybe those people don't need a license if they have a license. There's another, so the Power BI, so the Office 365 REST API also can give you a list of everyone who has a license. And that does not require any kind of admin privilege to get that. You can just query that and get a list of everyone who has a license. You can compare that to this and say, okay, you have been inactive for so long, you have a license, I want to pull it from you. And I have just general information about the users, what they're doing. So then reports, this is basically, you know, on and on, report usage. There's nothing really so much fun about it. This one here is a little bit different. I know you have a hard time seeing it, so I'm just gonna try to explain it because it's like in different places on it. But this is one where I'm using the refreshes of reports. So this could be valuable information as well. You can see, for example, on this graph here, this is average duration of refreshes of the same data set depending on the day. You can see it goes up and down. But it's also something like, what about this one below? This is like, at what time in the day did the refresh, did the report refresh, and how long time did it take? So This is a very common scenario you have in your Power BI environment, is that everyone is refreshing at 12 o'clock in the, you know, midnight, or 8 a.m. in the morning, or 12 midday, something like that, meaning that, you know, refreshes take a long time. Because it's, you know, you're either in a shared capacity or your dedicated capacity, it doesn't matter, it will take a long time. You can use this to tell them, hey, maybe you should move your refresh an hour earlier. It will run faster. So these kind of things can be used for these kind of purposes as well. And I have, you know, I have one gateway in my environment. This is just information about the gateway. That can be very useful. You will be able to get a list of all the gateways in your environment if you want, if you're an admin, which is a very, very useful information, because there has never been really a proper restriction of who can install gateways. So that potentially there are gateways in your environment that are being used by people that you don't know about. So this is also a very valuable information you can get. Okay, and then the same with capacities. So before I go back to my slides, is there anyone here who is running a dedicated capacity premium? Have you been using the capacities app within Power BI? Yeah. Okay, good. Because if you haven't, you definitely should. So there is a, within Power BI, under apps, there is a Power BI premium capacity metrics app. You can just get it by going to get apps. And you know, you will, this, because normally when you go to get apps, you will only see what is apps it's in your, you have access to within your organization. But if you go away from my organization to apps, you will get a bunch of other things that, you know, are created by third parties or Microsoft. And one of them is this is Power BI premium capacity. And this also works if you have embedded capacity. It will give you tons of information about performance of your capacity. Really, really important if you have, you know, capacity to have a look at that. You will see, you know, what is going on in your capacity. So, that was activities. I have a little bit more time. So, these were the objectives that I had. Hopefully, we have managed to get around them. We have a few minutes for questions, if you have any questions more about the last part of the audit log. Or anything else? Yes? Yeah. Eviction. Yeah, so the question was, if you have premium capacity, the app won't show you the actual storage of the data set. It will just show you it got evicted because there was no space in memory. There is actually nothing that you can do to get that. There's nothing, you know, there's the capacities API endpoint has very little. This is, what is it called? You know, I can create a capacity and do software things, but nothing really about it. I have heard this question before. I know Microsoft have heard this question before. Apparently, it is not so easy to determine the size of the storage, because, you know, when you process, it will, you know, almost double in storage, and then when you, you know, done processing, it will, you know, go down again, and these kind of things, you know, have, you know, impact on things that are in memory. So they have been asked, and hopefully they will deal with it, but there's no promises there, unfortunately. Yes. Yeah, so the question was, you know, if someone looked at a dashboard report, you know, in the audit log, will you see what they did with the output of it? So you will see if they exported it. There is an audit for that. You will see if they printed it, but only if they printed it, you know, with a PDF thing, you know. So if they took a screenshot, or if they just print the browser, you won't see that. That's because that's not a Power BI activity. So there is no guarantees in there. There are some, you know, indications. Yeah. More questions? Yes. So the question was, is it possible to see lineage from a gateway data set to an on-premise SQL server? So you can see when you query the data sources for data sets, which is one endpoint, you will see what the data source is, and you can link it to a data set. But unfortunately, you cannot link that to a gateway. There is no gateway to data sets thing, you know. But you can see the link between data source and our data set, and it will, in most cases, tell you accurately what type of data source it is, that it is a SQL server. But there's, you know, I have seen indications where it hasn't done that properly. No, unfortunately. Yeah. Okay, I think we will have to wrap it up now because I'm out of time. But if you know, I will be here on for more questions if you want. Thank you.